We have a lot of incredible opportunities here. There are things we will be able to do that human beings have dreamed of since the beginning of time. And it would be pretty awful if we managed to destroy ourselves, not because we created AI, but because we were afraid of it. The thing that has hampered mankind from the days that we first emerged has been that we have more problems than we have minds to apply to the problems. There are vastly, vastly more problems than we can think about. And we only have so many people, they only have so much stuff they can do all day long. And for the first time, we have the possibility of fixing that. We have the possibility that wherever we see a problem, we could apply intelligence to try to fix it. When you have artificial intelligence, really robust general artificial intelligence available, you have the ability, wherever you see something that needs fixing, to apply energy and time and thinking to fixing it, whether it's teaching children or spending an enormous amount of time on that niche disease that only has 500 sufferers per year. You are in a position to work on those things when you have artificial intelligence in a way that you simply could not before. This could be perhaps the best thing that has ever happened to us. And we risk screwing it up very badly by being so scared of it that we make the worst possible things happen instead. 30 years ago, if you'd asked someone, what's it going to take to have something you can have a conversation with? They would have assumed that you needed something that was almost fully human in its understanding of the world and the way that it functioned. Whereas a language model isn't like that at all. If you've ever watched a baby, you know, it takes them a couple of years to go from being able to do absolutely nothing to being able to walk around and talk and feed themselves, or at least sort of feed themselves by the time they're two. They're training their neural networks in much the same way that systems get trained now. A large language model is basically the result of what happens if you take an incredibly large amount of text and you train an AI to try to predict what the next word in the text is going to be. And that seems very strange when you start thinking about it, because we're used to, oh, I sit down in front of ChatGPT and I ask it to write me a poem or something. What does that have to do with predicting the next word? The way these things work is that they have a window of the previous text that they're looking at. You know, they look at the last, you know, 1,000, 2,000, 5,000, 8,000, however many it is, words in what you have typed in, and they try to predict what the next word that might come after that might be. If someone was to say to you, I left my car in the, you know, what would things that might come to mind be? Parking lot, garage, shade. There are a number of words that might reasonably come next. What these systems are built to do is to try to figure out what the next word that reasonably would appear in sequence would be. And the thing that's kind of strange and shocking is that if you try repeating this over and over again, the thing is capable of doing something like writing a haiku or a brief short story or an answer to that exam that you took home that you really, really needed to finish but procrastinated about. When people think about artificial general intelligence, what they're thinking about is a system that can do anything a human being can do as well as a human being can do it or better. There's nothing that prevents us from doing that eventually. Human beings have brains, and the brains are physical objects, and what nature can do, human beings eventually figure out how to do, whether it's flying or crossing oceans in boats or, you know, or getting to the moon. If things are physically possible, people eventually find ways to do them. The question is whether or not you would even, from a day-to-day point of view, want an artificial general intelligence. There are reasons that you would want something that's capable of cleaning your house, and there are reasons that you would want something that's capable of designing a new car. But do you really want things that are like people. And maybe we do. And maybe at some point, it turns out that it would be nice to have companies run by, you know, psychologically stable artificial intelligences instead of, you know, relatively volatile human personalities. Or maybe we wouldn't. That's a choice that I think people are going to end up exploring on both sides of it in coming years. Can a machine have consciousness? If you believe that the human brain is where, you know, your personality and how you look at the world and how you understand the world comes from. And that seems pretty clearly the case, right? You know, if you get brain damage, it affects your personality. So it's probably the case that human intelligence and personality and sense of self is centered in the brain. So if it's a physical thing, you can probably build computers that have it. Should we want to? That's not nearly as clear, because if you build something that has consciousness, it's a person. And if it's a person, you probably have to worry a great deal about whether you're treating it well. If I have a system that's very, very good at weeding a field, and it's a fairly simple image recognition system and something that kills weeds, I don't have to worry about whether I'm mistreating it. If it has self-awareness and thinks about the quality of its life and all of the rest of that stuff, you have to worry about that sort of thing a great deal more. What might be coming up in coming years is not, in fact, very general artificial intelligences, you know, with human-style motivations and fears and interests. And I don't want to make it sound sinister when I say not very human. Cars are not very human, right? Cars don't have internal motivations. We don't worry too much that our automobile is dissatisfied with its lifestyle. And it's that very non-human sort of feature to it that makes it useful as a tool. We're pretty happy with the fact that our toasters and our microwave ovens and our cars and our airplanes do things that are not very human and work in ways that are not very human. It's why we want them. The thing that has changed the most in the way that I viewed AI is the fact that narrower, non-conscious, not human-like, not even animal-like systems are a thing that we can build and use for very narrow purposes and, you know, and are not very worrisome in any way. Unless, you know, you're worried about, you know, what the long-term economic impact will be. I personally think that the long-term economic impact is going to be fantastic. It's going to mean that almost all of us live far better lives than we do now. But that's the sort of thing that one can argue about. There are other people who argue that AIs are very dangerous and are, you know, going to ultimately plot against us and kill us. I worry a great deal about the development of things like autonomous weapon systems. I worry a great deal about the development of surveillance systems that are almost impossible to evade. I worry a great deal about human beings deciding to misuse these systems. I worry much less about the systems deciding to misuse themselves. There's been an explosion of research on how you get these systems to safely behave in the way that you would like. And it's all because a lot of this is being done out in the open. The Doom faction risks creating a self-fulfilling prophecy by eliminating the possibility of having a wide segment of the population, a wide segment of scientists, of engineers, of ordinary people, look at these systems, figure them out, get their heads wrapped around them, and figure out ways to deal with the changes they bring. I think that people should try not to be afraid, because people who are afraid do stupid things. One of the things I really worry about is the possibility that, for example, the United States decides to, after a fashion, unilaterally disarm on this and leave all the AI development to totalitarian countries. you know, China, for example, we kind of guarantee bad outcomes if we do that sort of thing. If we're not doing any work on it and we leave all of it to people who have bad intentions, it seems to me to be inevitable that the good scenarios on this stuff involve people doing a lot of experiments and figuring things out. If you had asked anyone in 1990 who knew about the internet whether something like Twitter would appear and be a hit, anyone who claims that they would have figured that out is lying. The way we figured that sort of thing out was by experimenting, by people trying lots of stuff and seeing what worked. And I think that that's what the future holds for this stuff too. I don't think that most people probably should be spending a lot of their time obsessing about, will my job exist in 10 years or won't my job exist in 10 years or what have you. It's not a very productive way to spend your time, I think. Most people end up going through their lives not successfully planning what will happen in 20 years anyway. I have had a succession of plans myself about what I was going to be doing in 5 years or 10 years and 15 years, and absolutely none of them have come true. I think being open-minded and looking around you in the world and trying to take advantage of new ways of doing things is productive. I think spending your time trying to pretend that you can figure out the ideal way to structure your life so that you're perfectly positioned for what happens in 5 years it's never worked. And it's impossible to completely get rid of risk in life. Any of us could be hit by a car tomorrow or could get a cancer diagnosis. The things you should worry about are the things that are very risky or that you can do something concrete about. I wouldn't worry about AI too much if you're just a normal person who isn't in the field and is entering the workforce. I would try using it. I'd encourage people to, when they hear that there's new stuff around, to try using it, to try getting the benefits of it, to try wrapping their heads around it, figuring out how they can use it for their job day to day, to figure out what benefits it can bring to them. Because there's no point in living in an age where such things are available and not taking advantage.